Anybody in here ever felt like giving up, just throwing in the towel, just giving up? I'm not gonna ask you to hunch anybody, but just look at them. That person you're looking at is here tonight only because of God's mercy and His grace. Somebody ought to just tell God, thank you for your mercy and your grace that kept me.
Really had me
God's mercy kept me.
God's mercy.
Can I get a witness in here that knows about God's grace? So I'm here today. Somebody next to you tell me, I was really down. The devil really had me. But God's mercy kept me. I'm here tonight because of God's mercy. Come on now, just thank him. Just thank him.
I almost let go.
God's been good.
I'm gonna hold my head up, going on with the Lord. My mind is made up, yes, I'm on my
way up.
I'm gonna hold my
head up, going on with the Lord. Changing hand,
oh,
hold to his hand,
God's
unchanging hand.
You ought to
feel your hopes on things eternal.
Hold
to God's unchanging hand.
Well, hold to his hand,
God's unchanging hand. Changing hand.
I'm on my
way up.
Yes, I'm gonna hold my
head up. Going on with the Lord.
My mind is
made up.
And I'm on my
way up.
I'm gonna hold my
head up. Going on with the Lord.
This morning, I'm going to ask you all to turn in your Bibles to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And when you have arrived there, would you please stand out of respect for God's word? Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And we're going to begin reading at verse 10. 2 Corinthians. When you have arrived at that scripture text, would you please stand out of respect for God's word? Amen. If you're sitting next to someone and they don't have the word, share your word with them. Amen? Second Corinthians, chapter 9. Beginning at verse 10, reads as follows. Now he that ministereth seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food and multiplies your seed sown, and increase the fruits of your righteousness, being enriched in everything to all bountifulness, which causes through us thanksgiving to God. That's part of what we were just doing. For the administration of this service not only supplieth the want of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgiving unto God. Whiles by the experiment of this ministration, they glorify God for your professed subjection unto the gospel of Christ and for your liberal distribution unto them and unto all men. And by their prayers for you, which long after you for the exceeding grace of God in you, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift.
Amen.
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 Amen. And amen. Hallelujah. If you remember, a couple weeks ago, we spoke about how it is that we are to be built up so that we may be able to grow in Christ. Last week, we talked about the unity in the congregation and the unity that we have in the community when all of God's children, when all of us work together for the common good that Christ Jesus has died to give us. Amen?
Amen.
Today, we're going to speak from this vantage point. Check your environment. Check your environment. I recently read a line of words that resonated with me, and I felt it was appropriate to share this with you. It said that when a farmer sees there's something wrong with the flower, the farmer does not fix the flower. He fixes the environment in which the flower is growing. So he amends the soil. He removes the weeds that may be choking the flower. He changes the watering pattern. Because if the flower is drooping, it may need a little bit more water. And then if the petals on the flower are ragged on the edges, he may determine that that flower needs some more shade because it's out in the sun too much. See, the farmer knows that he cannot fix the flower. The flower can only be fixed by God. But there are some things that the flower or that the farmer can do. And I want to suggest to you this morning, and I don't want you to turn there. You can write the scripture down, but I don't want you to turn there right now. If we look at Matthew chapter 13, verses 3 through 9, Matthew chapter 13, verses 3 through 9, and verses 18 to 23, in those scriptures, and if you didn't have time to write those down, I'll give them to you at the end. You asked me for them at the end, and I'll give them to you. In those scriptures, it is clear that the environment in which the sower cast the seed, y'all remember the story, the parable about the seed sower. The environment in which the sower cast the seed impacts greatly the outcome of the seed's success for growth. You see, it's the environment that impacts the growth and success of that seed. And we remember that some of that seed went by the wayside. Some of that seed fell on stony ground. And some of that seed fell amongst some thorns. Y'all remember the story? Come on now. And in those three environments, the seed did not grow. Environment matters, y'all. But then the Bible says there was some seed that fell on good ground. And that seed, whoo! That seed grew and was nourished and flourished. So I share with you that today's text focuses on the sower of the seed. It focuses on the sower of the seed, the one who is doing the casting, the one who, according to the word here, ministers seed to the sower is God the Father. You see what the scripture says? You know, let me read it to you. He that ministereth seed to the sower, you see that right there? He that gives us the seed to sow. Y'all see where I'm going with this? You're the sower. You're the one who's supposed to be casting the seeds. And if the sower doesn't cast, the word can't get to those who do not know it. Everybody's not walking through that door right there. You understand what I'm saying? So it is that the one who is ministering to us, the seed is God the Father. We have to also understand that in the parable and in today's text, the seed is the word of God. So you can't just be throwing anything you want to throw. Amen. The sowers are those who share the word of God with those who are in dark places. You say, well, Rev, you know, it's daytime, so everybody's in the light. Well, just because the S-U-N is up in the sky does not necessarily mean that everybody that's walking in it is not walking in the light. You see, because the light that I'm talking about is the light of Jesus Christ. And everybody who is walking in the daytime or at night does not necessarily walk in the light. If you're not walking in the light, if you don't have Christ in your life, I want to suggest to you this morning that you're walking in darkness. And it's up to us to share the light with those in darkness. Now, there's two big questions that need to be asked. Number one, what kind of seeds are you casting? All right, I'm going to get to that in a minute. We're going to flesh that out in a minute so we can understand what I'm talking about. Number two, where did you get those seeds? I just want to be honest with you this morning. I don't want the people of God to walk thinking that you're doing the right thing and you sure enough are not doing the right thing. It's important that we recognize where we're getting our seed from. If you're not reading the Word of God, guess where you're getting your seed from? There's only two places. Either you're getting it from God or you're getting it from the devil. All right. I get too many amens on that, but still, the truth is the truth. There are three things that stick out that are significant for us in this message. We want to tie this message together so that we can receive the help that we need so that we can walk in the light of this new life that we have through Christ Jesus. In Wednesday's Bible study, our new topic is taking possession of the new life. And see, some of us will never take possession of that new life because we don't know how it's tied to and connected to the Word of God. So if you're not reading the Word of God, and there's some of us who, you know, for whatever reason, you know, laziness, whatever the reason, are not reading the Word of God. So if you're not reading it, and if you're not coming to Bible studies to ask necessary questions so that you can get the right answer, then there's a good chance that you're casting seeds that God didn't ask you to cast. Amen? Amen. So having said that, number one, the seeds you sow ministers bread for your food. See how it said that? The seed that you throw, and I started to bring some little pieces of paper like there were seeds, but I didn't feel like picking them all up. So I said, no, that's not a good idea. And that vacuum cleaner that we have here is not all that great. So, but just imagine me throwing some seeds out here, right? The seed that we throw, look at what the scripture says. The seed that we throw becomes our food. And you might think, I'm going to turn my back to you for a second. You might think that it's food for the person who's receiving it. But that's not what the scripture says. The scripture says the seed that we throw becomes our food. Y'all see that? So we have to understand that this message uses a physical idea to help us to understand its spiritual application. Come on now, somebody. The seed is the Word of God. We cannot sow, we cannot throw, we cannot cast what we do not know. We must take great care when we open our mouths. As children of God, we must know that being quiet sometimes is good. You don't always have to be the one carrying the conversation. You don't always have to be the one who's talking. And I would like to suggest that unless the Lord asks you to open your mouth, it might be a good idea to be quiet. If we speak hate, You get angry and you want to hurt somebody that hurts you. I want to suggest to you that that's not from God. Where'd you get that seed anyway? Because hate is seed too. Amen, somebody. Where'd you get that seed? You know where you got that seed from. You better burn that seed up. Aggression. You know, you come into, you know, Social Security office and you see the long line of folk. And they say, take a number and sit down. And you just sitting there. And you know how you all aggressive and you want to make your point and you want to, you see all this stuff? Take that down. Breathe. You know that all that aggressiveness that you have pent up in you, because you want things and you want them your way, that's not of God. Impatience. Not of God. But on the flip side, you walk in the love and the light of Jesus Christ. Woo! You've just changed the whole environment, didn't you? Come on now, somebody. We've got to begin to recognize that these things that are in our life, like love, become seed. And when you throw out love, guess what you want to get back? You're going to get some love. And guess what? Sometimes, even when you throw stuff out, you throw seed out, sometimes it doesn't come back as love. Not that seed, but maybe this other seed over here that I threw, I can get some love from that seed. So we can't worry about folk who, even though we're trying to help them, don't love us the way we want to be loved. We can't worry about that. This is God's in control of this seed. Amen? It's his seed anyway. It don't belong to me. I'm just doing what God said to do. Amen, somebody. So, I want to sow kindness. I want to sow joy. I want to sow peace. See, when you want to sow these things, you can't sow that just because you said it. Because I need to know what that is. I need to know what love is. You know, there's a lot of different kinds of love out going around here. And some of it ain't of God. Matter of fact, the whole lot of it ain't of God. And sometimes folk talk about the, you know, joy, but they're talking about it from a worldly context. But my Bible lets me know that this joy I have, the world didn't give it to me, and the world can't take it away. Somebody needs to say amen up in here. Remember, do not be quick to speak. Because the moment you open your mouth, if you open it, it can jack up the environment. It can mess up the whole environment. It is not difficult for us to envision how this seed becomes food for our spirit. As physical food feeds our body, spiritual food, which is the seed, which is the word of God, feeds our spirit. And see, in the physical, we might be nice and strong and physical and, you know, might be in good shape and stuff. But the spirit inside of us might be this little tiny thing like this. You know, you can't even see this from back where you are if you're sitting in the back seat. I don't want to have this big physical body with all these muscles. Y'all see these muscles, right? And then have this little old tiny thing that I call the spirit on the inside. See, I want the spirit inside of me to be so big that it's busting loose. It's busting loose. So that when I'm standing in the line at the Social Security, and this spirit that's inside of me is busting loose, somebody next to me says, something going on here. I feel something. What's this? And they don't realize it's you and the spirit that's busting loose in you. Come on now. They say, are you all right? And see, the moment somebody speaks to you, they've opened the door for you to open your mouth. Come on now, somebody. But open it. Don't open it for you. Don't make yourself big. Make God big. Glorify the Lord. You understand what I'm saying? So, long before we open our mouths to speak for Christ and sow seeds, there's something we must do. We must read, study, and meditate to understand the word for ourselves. Some of us run out there, and I know this was me. This was me. I guarantee you this was me. You know, I got saved one day. I was in college, you know, and I was a junior in college. And Sister Hooker, I went back home. I was going to evangelize all these knuckleheads I grew up with, all these weed smokers and stuff, and got back to my house. And my house was the gathering place for all this stuff. My house was the gathering place for all these knuckleheads. And sure enough, Sister Hooker, when I got home, they was all there. And I started talking about Jesus. And these... Everybody was just... There's a cloud in the room. You know what I'm talking about. And they were just laughing at me. See, I went before I had the foundation underneath me to be able to substantiate the words that I was saying. So it is that we need to make sure that we're undergirded and we're standing not on self. See, I was going in the knowledge that I had up here. I wasn't going based on what had filtered down to my heart because it hadn't gotten there yet. So we've got to know that we've got to come and learn something first. Then we can go out and be effective witnesses for Christ and be able to cast seeds. So we must allow the word to become our bread, our food, before it will ever be effective in becoming effective for others. I think I said that backwards. We have to allow it to affect us so it can affect others. Amen, somebody? Amen. Affect me so I can affect somebody else. If it has not gotten to your heart, if it has not affected you, what on earth makes you think it's going to affect somebody else? Come on now. How? Where? And when we read and study the word is important as we connect the depth of our understanding and the rate of our growth to the environment in which we learn. I know that's a whole lot of words, isn't it? But all I'm saying to you is environment matters. Where I learn matters. One of the many benefits that we have from making sure our environment is right is that learning takes place. Noise versus quiet. Is the TV on? Is the radio blasting? Are you outside or inside? Are you sitting in the sun or are you sitting in the shade? All of these things impact our ability to absorb what we are learning. I know for me, I'm sitting in English class. I can remember, you know, back in the day, a gazillion years ago, if somebody around me was talking, I could not comprehend what I was reading. And Sister Francina and I were having this conversation the other day. That's why I always sat in the front. Some people were trying to say I was a goody two-shoes. I was trying to, you know, kiss up to the teacher. But I knew how it is that I learned best. And if I was sitting in the back with the rest of the knuckleheads, I wasn't going to learn a thing. So it's important that we make our environment out to a place where our environment is conducive so that we can learn. We must remove from our environment all distractions. Amen. Cell phones, people, schedules that will hinder our growth. We got to get rid of it. And I ain't saying you got to kick your kids out and tell your husband to go off somewhere or something like that. Tell your wife to go shopping or something just so you can study the word. But what I do have to do is pick a time when folk are down. So I choose 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning.
Amen.
You know, I know everybody's asleep. Ain't nobody getting up in my house that early except me. It is dead quiet. Matter of fact, the birds ain't even chirping yet. Because that can be a distraction too. It's important that you choose a time to spend with God where somebody's not going to knock on the door. Mommy, I need something. Daddy, can I get an extra dollar? Mr. Softy is coming down the street. You know, all this stuff. You know what I'm saying? And then folk blowing up your phone, talking about nothing. Turn the phone off. Give God the time that God deserves so that he can place it not just in your head, but also in your heart. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Number two, God who provides the seed, which is the word, to the sower that allows us to grow. Y'all remember that little thing I did a little earlier? The person who receives might be growing too, but as we throw it, I have to learn it before I can throw it. So I'm getting this growth that the Bible promised, in that the seed becomes soul food, and that seed is multiplied as we sow it. So I don't sow it one time and say, oh, I got it, I'm done. I did what you told me to do. No. The more you sow it, the more what happens? The more you grow. The more I sow, what happens and the effect of that is multiplied over and over. And I love it because there's some benefits to sowing the seed. And the benefits to sowing the seed, according to the word, see where it says there, where it talks about our righteousness? The fruit of our righteousness, the fruit that comes from us sowing seed, the fruit is increased. Our righteousness is increased. So that I don't worry about who's sitting next to me. I don't worry about fake friends. You know what I'm saying? Fake friends have already jacked me up enough. I ain't worried about what they think. I'm looking for the righteousness of Christ that will dwell in me richly so that I can walk in a way that's pleasing only to him. And y'all know I love my wife. But when it comes to the word, I ain't trying to please her. And vice versa, she ain't trying to please me. I believe that's why our relationship has worked so well. We know our place. I know I'm in second. I ain't first in her life. I'm second. I'm second, right? I just wanted to make sure I wasn't third, you know what I'm saying? Fourth. Woo. Anyway, Lord have mercy. Let's get back to the word. But I love that God operates with these numbers. I always loved numbers when I was in school. And I love this about God because God is a numbers God. And it says in the word that he multiplies. It doesn't say add. See, if you add, it's going to take you a long time to get to, you know, 1,000. But if you multiply, woo! Ain't going to take long at all. But there's some things that God has desired us to do to get that multiplication factor to be what we, you know, desire it to be in our own head at least. And we've got to know that God has already provided. God has already done his part. All we got to do is walk where he told us to walk. Somebody needs to say amen around here. Whew. Because Christ multiplies the word so that what comes from our mouths greatly affects those who hear the word, we recognize that it's God that gives the increase in spiritual attributes that become our fruit of righteousness. So the attributes, the characteristics of God are multiplied in us so that, you know, you might be one of those people like me who was impatient. And I still might have a little bit of that running around inside me. But the Lord has dealt with me on that so that now I can stand in line, and even if the line is long, I can get up to the front and I can be pleasant when I get there. Amen. Thank you. And look, there might be some stuff running in my head that might want to say, yell at this person. But you know, most of the time, the person we're mad at and yelling at had nothing to do with the reason why we're upset and mad and stuff, why we're impatient. They got a job. All they're doing is taking your money, taking your slip. They ain't the boss. If you want to get mad, well, don't get mad at them, but if you wanted to get mad at somebody, get mad at their boss. You know what I'm saying? Don't get mad at them. They low on the totem pole. They barely making it. You know what I'm saying? And you up there mad at them, and they don't even know why you mad. Hallelujah, somebody. God gives us the increase in spiritual attributes that becomes our fruit of righteousness. As we speak, the very words of God. So you can't come speaking what you want to speak. Oh, I know what you might want to say might be all important to you, but it ain't got nothing to do with the word of God. Therefore, it's not important to God. It's important that we speak the very words of God. It's important that we come to learn so that we're standing not on our own ability, we're standing because Jesus Christ has allowed us to stand. It does. That's why I said earlier, it does not matter what fake friends say. Even if my wife says something to me that hurts me, look, don't sit there and act like I always say what's right. Because the truth is, sometimes, you know, I say things and I wish I could take it back. And that's why I said it's all right for us to be quiet sometimes. Because words are like a shot arrow. You know, you have the bow and arrow. You see that analogy? I shoot the arrow. I can't run over there and get the arrow while it's flying through the air before it hits the wall. I ain't that quick. You know what I'm saying? And words are like that. Once they're out, good luck trying to get that back. Christ, our Savior, and the word as it's heard affect in multiplication those who hear it. Well, how does it affect us, Rev? It affects us because it increases our faith. It increases our faith so that we become more inclined to sow the seeds, even in places where, you know, we formally would never have spoken about Jesus Christ. But we find ways to take people's words and to flip it so that, Lord have mercy. You know something? What you just said made me think about something that happened to me when I was reading the Word of God. See, just like that, we just changed the whole conversation. We changed the environment in which the conversation was going. See, they was talking about the weather. And now all of a sudden, you just changed it because you know that Jesus calmed the storm. He calmed the storm. He said, you know what I'm saying? And you made it smooth too, so that they don't even know what you just did. You just talked about Jesus and they was talking about, you know, what's that guy's name on the weather station? Don't matter, whatever his name is, her name is. They was talking about weather, now you're talking about Jesus. And that is how we minister. Long before we speak or cast seeds to those who do not know anything about Jesus, we must first speak in our own homes. You done joined the outreach team and everything. And you ain't never said a word to your children, ain't never said a word to your husband, ain't never said a word to your wife about, you know, the word of God. See, and those are the best people to talk to it about. Because even if you make a mistake, they ain't gonna know, but you know. They become our practice subjects so that, you know, when we're telling the story to them, even if it's somebody we know is difficult to talk to, somebody that professed to never pick up Jesus, all we got to do is picture them, that person, being our child, being our husband, being our wife, and us speaking to them plain. They may still reject it, but guess what? At least I got it out. And what happens when we sow seeds, even if those seeds fall on bad soil, a hard place, at least what I've done, I've grown, because I've sown the seed. I've done what God has called me to do. See, how the seed grows, that's not up to us. How the flower gets back to being where it used to be, that's not up to us. But what we have in our ability to do is what God has given us to do. And that is what God is going to judge us on. Amen, somebody. Amen. What happens when we sow seeds in our own home is we begin to shape the environment of that home. We begin to understand so that our children, so that our husband, so that our wife begins to understand that time is out on anything happening up in here. See, we're going to operate based on something new, something different. And what that is what God has called it to be. So the environment becomes what God wants it to become. See, checking our environment really means, look, if my son is operating in some meanness, or he's even dating somebody and he's being mean to that person, I got to check him. I got to make sure that I cultivate the soil around his feet so he's standing on good ground. And it does not matter what happened yesterday or last week or last month. What happens from this day forward, that's what matters. Check your environment. When you begin to do all the things that God has called you to do, your house now will become a place where the Spirit of God wants to dwell. And when the Spirit of God dwells in your house, guess what's going to happen? It's going to spill out. The Spirit don't stay, you know, and you don't control where the Spirit stays. If the Spirit is there and it's being multiplied, what will happen is it's going to affect your neighbor. It's going to affect how you act towards your neighbor. It's going to, hey, how you doing? I don't even know folk. I'll be saying to folk walking up and down the street, hey, how you doing? I'll be saying hi to them like they're my friend. They'd be looking at me kind of crazy. Who this fool? Who this black man over here saying hi to me? I don't care. I don't care. But the deal is this. The Spirit will begin to move. Number three, and finally, we can see that when we are in line with that which God has called us to, he supplies our every need and even the things we want. But there's a catch. Well, I shouldn't say there's a catch. There's the word. The reality about things that we want, unless those things that we want are in line with God's will for us, we shouldn't be asking for them no way. So the results of our abundant thanksgiving affects how we come to the house of God. I'm not ever going to come to the house of God reserved. I ain't doing it. Not me. See, the Bible tells us how to come. What's it say about entering the gates? does it say about entering the court? So when you come to the house of God, that's how you should be coming. That's the gate. So when I enter it, woo! Now, y'all probably don't understand the woo because you probably never played tag like we played tag back in the day. See, we had some bad hombres. And see, I was one of the younger people. So, you know, I used to get kind of picked on a little bit because I was easy to catch until the Lord gave me some wheels. You know, my brother was a bigger dude, you know what I'm saying? So I was, you know, a thin fella, but I could move, you know what I'm saying? So when I got to that base, and the base was the telephone pole, okay? When I got to that base, I slid on that ground, didn't matter whether it was gravel, didn't matter whether it was sand, I slid and I touched that, woo! See, that's where I get the woo from, you know what I'm saying? So when I come to the house of God, it does not matter what I've been through. Doesn't matter who's been chasing me all week long. Doesn't matter, you know, what the devil was on my track or not. When I get to the house of God, woo! Thank you. It's shouting time. It's time to praise God. It's time to lift him up. It's time to worship God. Hallelujah, somebody. You see, we've got to learn how to change the environment, shape the environment, so that the environment becomes what God wants it to be. I'm telling you right now, Sister Sylvia, don't expect Javay to come in through the door all reserved, prim and proper. I'm coming through, woo! You see what I'm saying, Brother Marcon? God has been good to me. He's picked me up. He's turned me around. He's placed my feet on solid ground. I know what the God can do. I've been working with him for a minute. I know he's able to help me shape the environment in which I'm in. So I get excited about the small things. I get excited every time I think about how good God has been. When I just think about the goodness of my Lord, while I'm yet in the land of the living, I know that God is able to keep me. I know that God can hold me. I know that God is able to pick me up. Every day ain't howdy howdy, but I know this, that my God is able. He can do the impossible. All the stuff that I can't do, God is able to do. When I pick it up his word and I see what he's done for me, I get encouraged so I can run on in the name of Jesus. I can run on because I know the Spirit is with me. I can understand the essence of his presence. Hallelujah. The time is getting late. So I want everybody to stand on their feet.
Through Jesus Christ, who is both our Lord and Savior, I am Reverend Javay Barger, pastor of Peace Missionary Ministries here at 90 Main Street, New Britain, Connecticut. We are a multicultural church with a heart to serve all races. As you can tell, we love to worship, teach, and preach the Word of God. If you ever want to join us, our address is on the screen, or call for a ride at 860-681-7251. God bless you, and we hope to see you real soon.